30 years. And sexist though it may sound, it roughly coincides with the amount of time that women have been involved in the role of town clerk. It's been seen more as a secretarial position rather than an important historic recording position. The office of town clerk is actually a multifaceted faceted administrative profession requiring organizational management and interpersonal skills. And it can be divided into five distinct administrative roles: legislative administrator, chief election officer, chief public information administrator, public records and licensing administrator, and census voter registration administrator. And the town clerk has to be knowledgeable of all the laws as well as all the roles and responsibilities of all formal arms of town government, because you've got to deal with all the boards and committees in some way or another, and you've got to interact with county government, with the courts, and with several state. So I didn't come to this job with my eyes closed. I started 56 years ago by sneaking into the town office and visiting with Violet Parker while she worked as town clerk. And I used to drive her crazy with my millions of questions. And when the position came up as an opening, Violet kind of encouraged me to apply for it. So I did. I started in November 1979, and I spent the first month before I became town clerk doing all the clerk's work, preparing all the documents and everything for the clerk's signature at the end of the week. And I read Mass General laws and election laws for hours on end. The selectmen assigned my hours. My starting salary was $500 per year for 50 weeks, a pay rate of $1 an hour. This was 1979, remember. And it was a rude awakening to discover that at the end of the first year, I'd put in over 750 hours. Since those days, the town population has more than doubled, and so has the time required to fulfill the clerk's duties. Since January, I've already put in 550 hours this year. And I could go on, but I won't. Did I make it?
You made it.
Please, come on up. And since you're new at this, you can introduce yourself to everybody.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'm Sheila Harrington. I'm running for town clerk, but you already know that. I work at Greenfield Savings Bank. I know most of you from there. I am almost finished with my degree in office management, and I'm very organized. I have excellent customer, customer service experience. And one thing I really want to bring to the office is evening hours, and I'd like to try to bring in a Saturday hours. And that was my main reason, is because if you ever try to get something done, no offense, but I can't ever get in there, because she has the same hours that I have at the bank. And it doesn't work out very well for the average working mother nowadays. And I don't have the experience of her of knowing all the paperwork and all that, but I am a very fast learner. I've learned a lot through the years, and I have no problem reading. I'm already a notary. I don't know what else I can offer you, but if you have any questions, just please ask.
Did the article about town clerk being appointed or elected get any votes? I don't know which one that is. I just wonder how that relates, how voting this year for clerk relates to the appointment if that passes.
Well, that'd be a good, could that be an answer to that? Yeah, please, town administrator.
We're in the process of confirming this with town council, but our current understanding is that the election will go go forward and that the person who wins the election will serve a term, which is 3 years, as town clerk, and at that point, the position will move to being appointed. That has yet to be confirmed, but that's our current understanding.
Okay. Is there any other candidate running for office who would like to speak?
I'm unopposed, but I just want to say hi.
Cindy Woman.
So because I'm unopposed, I don't have to go up front. So I was born the year that Gerald Levitt retired. I'm just finishing my 11th year on school committee. I started at the grammar school. I cannot remember why I started or who talked me into it. But I actually had to put a lot of thought into running this year. I thought maybe it was time for some new blood. But we don't have a lot of people that like to volunteer the kind of time that you really do have to give for school committee. And so I've been there 11 years. This is my third year as chair. So I'm the facilitator there. I try to let everybody have their say, but at the same time, not too much of a say. We are taped, so you can go to the lovely local channel and watch us if you would like to. I was going to give it up because Marty Baird is retiring. I don't know if you all know that, but she is one of the most wonderful superintendents that anyone could ever ask for. She's the most transparent, most friendly, most welcoming person. And so we went through this process this year that we just went through 3 years ago to get her, and it was very extenuating and it was very cumbersome, and the people who were on that committee, I was not on it, I was smart enough to delegate that, did a lot of hard work, and we hired Dr. Lynn Carey from New Hampshire, and she seems to have the same personality, so I decided that it would be rude to not at least give her some of the old members, I'm an old member now, one more round and maybe get her going. Again, she seems to be following in Marty's footsteps, and I hope so, and our committee did a great job. So I hope I get your vote for one more round. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to fall right into the two articles that got the most check marks tonight, by a long shot, by the way, are Article 3 and Article 4. So this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to read you Article 3, and then Article 4, and then I'm going to open up the floor to a representative of the selectmen or the fire department, whoever wants to come forward and speak about this first, and then we'll deal with it that way. Article 3 says, to see if the town will appropriate $151,000 to pay a portion of the cost for purchasing a pumper truck for the fire department. And to meet this appropriation, the treasurer, with the approval of the Board of Selectmen, is authorized to borrow said amount under and pursuant to Chapter 44, Section 7, Subsection 9 of the General Laws, or pursuant to any other enabling authority, and to issue bonds or notes of the town, therefore provided, however, that any bonds issued pursuant to this vote shall mature in not more than 5 years from their date of issue, excluding the term of any notes that may be issued in anticipation of the issuance of any such bonds, said borrowing to be contingent upon the passage of Proposition 2.5 debt exclusion ballot question, or take any other action relative thereto. That is a 2/3 vote. Article 4, to see if the town will transfer $285,000 from the capital stabilization fund to pay for a portion of costs of purchasing a pumper truck for the fire department, or take any other action relative thereto. Is also a 2/3 vote. Those are the two articles in question. Bob, since this is about your fire department first, would you like first?
Yes.
Thank you. Bob Baker,
the fire chief.
Charts and graphs.
A little bit of background first before we get started here. The truck that we're trying to replace is a 1990.
Okay? That's a good thing to know.
Short people. It's a 1990. The NFPA standard nowadays is maximum life expectancy of a fire truck, they rate at 22 years. Ours is 26 years old. It was supposed to have been scheduled to be replaced last year, but because of other issues in town that took place, it got bumped up another year to this year. That's why you see it on your town meeting floor now. To go along with this, we formed a committee many, many months ago. Six firemen, there's three of them in the background right now. Ron Hawks, Chris Herman, and Adam Baker there, and there was two others on it, also was. And we tried to form a committee to try to keep the cost down as much as possible, and but yet get the type of vehicle we need to does all the functions that we have it to do. It sounds like an enormous amount of money. Al was sick beside heart failure when we found out how much these things cost compared to 26 years ago. But we put our committee together. We made cuts. We made changes. One of those. I'm not going to lie to everybody sitting here, but one of the reasons why this truck costs a little bit more than normal is because we had to shrink it down by almost 5 feet. The standard length of a fire truck is 31 feet. That's their base models, all manufactured base models. We had to shrink it down to 25 feet, 6 inches long to get it in our garage. When you do that, you have to go into new engineering, and you have to try to figure this to make it fit in your space. The first company we contacted looked at it, which was, it was Pierce, which is pumping trucks like the town of Greenville and a few other towns have them. They came to us and said, we don't feel that we can build a truck to fit into your space. So we're out of place. So we said, okay, now what we're gonna do, we move on to another company. We moved on to a second choice company, which are all very adequate. We were communicating with the top three companies in the nation, okay? The second company is KME, Kovacs Mobile Equipment, which like South Eagles trucks and stuff like that. A few other towns have got some of their trucks. They came in and said, yes, we can build you a truck to fit in your garage. After many hours of deliberation with them, the only problem was our truck, we tried to keep the water, quantity of water in our truck the same as we have now, which is 1,000 gallons. They said, we can only build your truck with 800 gallons of water. And the cost is going to be $525,000. And we all went, oh! So we met again, and we talked it over, and we said, we think we'd better be looking for a third company. So we went to the company that we've been dealing with now, which is Rosenbauer America. Towns of Leverett and a few other towns around have some of their pumpers and had very good luck with them. They are the largest manufacturer of fire trucks in the world. They have a big sales in the foreign countries. Can one of you guys come up here? Chris, can you come up here a minute? I just want to show you, this is the copy of the specs. 64 pages of specs for a simple fire truck. Not a lot. This is not just a normal truck, this is a multi-purpose vehicle. The reason it's a multi-purpose vehicle is because firefighting has changed in the last few years. It's required of all our people, not only to, and I'm going to let Chris talk a little bit in a few minutes, not only do we have to just go out and fight our fires in our own community, we have to be available to respond to anywhere in the most often Franklin County area under the Tri-State Mutual Aid with a pumper truck and a minimum of 4 personnel on board. Right now when we go, we have to take 2 separate vehicles. We have to find a place for the private vehicles to park away from the fire scenes when we get there. And being a member of the Tri-State Fire Mutual Aid system, it has been recommended for the last 10 years that when people start replacing trucks, try to build yourself a truck that you can show up with all your people on board that are needed to run that pumper. Okay, that's for mutual aid pumpers. The other thing that we have gotten into and very successful with what they call a RIT team, a rapid intervention team. They call upon our firefighters when we have big structure fires in Franklin County to go as a RIT team, which is a team of 4 to 5 firemen, one officer and 4 other people that are equipped, and our job when we get there is just to stay there on the sidelines and not going to be used unless we have to go into that burning structure and save other firefighters that are trapped. And these group of our people have been very well trained. Chris was in on a training and he could explain a little of that training to it. It's a fantastic training ceremony. Adam was in it, a bunch of the others, and it's unbelievable. They're equipped with scat packs. They have stoke baskets for them. They even carry a separate pack with air in it that they carry into the house to put on the backpack, or put on the back of the injured firefighter or firefighters, so they can continue breathing while they get them out of the structure. And so firefighting has totally changed a lot in the last 3 years. And the other thing, the reason for this multi-cab versus 4 people in the back plus your driver in your officer's seat on the other side. The other reason for that is we have to, years ago, we didn't think much about the safety of our firefighters. But today, it's number one. Without the safety of your own people, what good are we? What really good are we to you citizens if we go there and we get injured? But we don't protect our own people. So this cab was designed so that when we go out in the dead of the summer, our firefighters in full dress gear get heat exhaustion real fast. So we have to have an area that we can put them in and cool them down and cycle them through as they're working. Okay? So that's what partially that 5-man cab is for. It has air conditioning. And it's the same token in the wintertime. Last year we had a structure fire up in our polling district. It was 17 below zero. And we're squirting water and trying to put somebody's house on. And we have to take care of our firemen as far as that for cold exposures. So we could cycle them through this vehicle and get them warmed back up and get them back out on the front line so they can work some more. And believe it or not, because of the heat and the cold, it doesn't take long for your firemen to have adverse effects because of that. So this is really a major piece of equipment for the town of Conway. It has a 1,250 gallon pump, 1,000 gallons of water. There's ladders over on the other side, as you can see. Nothing really fancy. There's something different on the truck that we didn't have before. We have asked to have the town of Conway fund us a portable generator driven by a hydraulic system on the truck. Because how many people in town, and you now have your little gas engines at home and your lawnmowers or your weed whackers, that this new ethanol gas is driving them crazy. Sometimes they don't start properly. You have all kinds of fits from them. You have to send them to the workshop, all of them to be repaired. These hydraulic generators, you just flip the switch and they come on and they power up your generation until you run cords out for your lighting, or if we had to go to somebody's house because the power is out. Some citizens have oxygen units that have to be powered to run so they can breathe properly. You can run cords out for the oxygen units to keep them from having serious health issues. And the other thing it has that truck now is a foam system. Years ago, our foam systems were, and what we have right now, it's just a 5-gallon pail on the ground. You drag out a 5-gallon pail of foam, pull the hose, and hope you got the adjustment right. You suck out of the pail, and you apply your foam. Nowadays, we use foam for brush fires. We use foam for Class A house fires. We have special types of foam we use for car fires with ethanol gas. Okay, so firefighting with foam has gone a long distance. This has a foam system with just a 30-gallon tank, storage tank built in underneath that you put your foam in. So you start your foam system up, you adjust whatever you want for percentages, and it shoots it right out to the fire lane. You don't have to worry about messing with pails on the ground and things like that. And it lasts for hundreds and hundreds of thousands of gallons of water. Chris, you got those?
So you boys want to open up for questions?
This is, if you want to see what the cab, front of the cab looks like, that's what it looks like, basically. This truck has been shrunk down to fit in our garage. width-wise, height-wise, the standard truck, people probably ask us, why didn't we go with a regular three-man cab? Well, I think I explained that to you about the multifunction this vehicle needs to be for our firefighters' use. And that's why we went to the six-man cab.
The only other thing with the six-man cab you don't get with the conventional cab is, in here, the Scott Packs, the SCBAs that everybody wears when they go into a building, currently they're stored on the outside of the truck, so when you get there, you have to get out and put them on. With these trucks, they're built into the seats, so as you're going to the call, whoever's not driving is putting that gear on. Cut down on a little bit of time.
How much shorter do you have to make it than what ordinary would be?
Ordinary was 31 feet. We had to cut it down to 25 feet 6.
So you couldn't put a 6-foot bump out in the back then?
Of the back of the building?
You would be out over the septic tank and the riverbank.
Bob, as someone who supported the town garage and was disappointed when it was voted down, did you have an idea of how much more this vehicle costs than the standard one would have cost?
It's tough to come up with a cost, but they estimated it's probably about $35,000 to shrink it down. $35,000 to $40,000, that range, to shrink it down.
I talked with one of the members of your committee, I think, and he showed me some of the numbers. And it kind of persuaded me a lot to go for this project. As I understood it, you know the numbers better than I, but as I understood it, you started out with like $500,000+ for the cost of this unit.
That was an estimate.
And through a lot of hard work, as I understand it, you were able to cut it down by tens of thousands of dollars just by tweaking here and tweaking there. And that made a big difference on my own understanding of what the starting point was, and then the work that was put into this to get it down. And what is the final? What were those numbers?
436,000 is the total now. We're looking at over 500 originally.
Right. So I just give a lot of credit to the committee just for doing that exercise.
You know, we worked very diligently, and I think Ron, if you would like to speak on some of that about how we worked very hard to try to drive the price down.
The only comments I have is one of the things we talked about. Getting a truck with a conventional cab like we have, and we talked with this manufacturer, and to build a truck like this with a conventional cab, which is 2 or 3 passenger, would be over $350,000 just for that. And so there's a lot of features that we wouldn't get that we get on this truck here, like this, the seats with the Scott Packs in them and some other stuff. And one of the, this truck here doesn't have very many bells and whistles on it, because one of the reasons that we went with some of the equipment on it, the last time we bought a truck, we cheapened it down to get the figures down, and now we have some people that can't operate the truck because of some of the controls and stuff on it. They just can't open the valves and stuff because they work so hard. And that's one of the things we incorporated in this truck is valves and equipment that people on the department can operate. So, I mean, that's about all I got to add.
Did they make these things in four-wheel drive? This is four-wheel drive?
This is not four-wheel.
They do make it in four-wheel drive, but we're not fitting our station because of the height requirements. We got 10-foot doors. We had to put a 9'8" maximum limit on to get in the door.
What does that have for a power plant, man?
It has a 450 horsepower Cummins diesel engine with an Allison 3000 5-speed transmission, and the transmission has, we asked it to have the fifth gear locked out, because most of your calls in Conway, you don't need an extra high-speed gear, so when we leave town to go on mutual aid calls, or have to get out on 91, or down in Deerfield, the operator can select that fifth gear and go up to that fifth gear.
Do you have a jake brake on it?
It does have a jake brake on it, yes. We specify the jake brake. It has also, you can't really see it very good here. You don't see the light here. I guess it's in yellow. You can't see it. Automatic tire change on the back.
Yeah.
You flip the switch to change for down on the tires.
Same thing the other engine and tanker had.
That's good.
For icy roads and winter road conditions that we're always out in.
Questions in the back?
If we buy this, what happens to the old one?
The old one will be put out for public auction sale, and that money would go back to the junk fund.
Okay. Do you have an idea of how much?
We estimate, and this is just a guesstimate, I should say, not
yeah, okay.
5,000 to 8,000 probably. Somebody back?
That was approximately that some of the companies will give us for trade-in. It's $5,000 to $8,000, so it's not worth it to deal with the trade-in. You can probably get more money on an open bid, open auction. Got a question?
Can you explain why we need a new truck?
Yeah. Well, we don't put a lot of miles on the truck a year. But it shows age because of the years we've had in service. We just had the pump work done last fall because it stopped pumping. So we had to have the seals replaced in the pump. It was out of town for, 4 weeks, 3 weeks? We had that replaced. The automatic governing system does not work on it, and I tried to get the gentleman who fixed the pump asking me if he could spend some time, an hour or two, looking at it. He spent 4 hours on it. He said, "Chief," he says, "I don't want to tell you this, but it isn't worth fixing. I would have to tear the whole system out. That type of governance system," and I'll explain to you what this is in a second, "isn't even being used anymore. It was used 25 years ago. It's totally obsolete nowadays. A governance system is a system that manages your truck speed and your pump pressure according to what you have for water flows. So in other words, when we have a fire at your house and we have two lines out, two big pumper lines out, and they're running at 125 pounds pressure, and all of a sudden one of the guys gets in trouble with something, they have to shut their nozzle off, it doesn't send that 125 pounds back to the truck and force 250 pounds out to the other line and send them guys flying through the air. It compensates all that. That's what the governance system does. It compensates the truck. So it's manageable for the firefighters at all times. The other thing that age was, he felt that it wasn't, you could put thousands and thousands of dollars into it. He says, but we would have to go with a new modern system that's available to us today. And he says, and I'm not so sure we could adapt it to your truck. This was a major fire truck coming in, were they from New Hampshire, right?
Yes.
Adam, New Hampshire.
Bob, how long do they suppose this truck will last? Are we going to get 26 years out of this one?
Well, I would hope so. Again, this truck, I'm not going to lie to you. This truck, you probably got quite a few thousands of dollars worth of extra cost into this truck because it has to be certified by the National Fire Protection Association. And what they do is they require, if you purchase a fire truck from a fire truck company, it has to meet their standard specs or they can't sell it to you. And what their standard specs does is creates the safety for your firefighters. This thing has rollover protection on it. And everything that the NFPA requires it to have. Pump sizes are a minimum requirement and all this foam systems and all these things. I mean, Ron is old school like I am. He said, why can't we just do away with this and cut the cost some? They can't sell you the truck. They can't sell you the truck.
Your thing to do, yes. I see you getting at least 25 plus years out of the truck.
So you got to remember, the only thing is in FPA regs, after a truck is 25 years old, they do not recognize it as a piece of firefighting equipment. You may have a truck that's perfectly good, it fights fire. But if you have equipment that's not recognized, your fire insurance rates go up.
Right.
Well, then I'll go with, will it last 24 years? And my point was, 24 years ago, did you have the cell phone that you have now in your pocket? So things change in 24 years. And sounds like this is upgraded, but it's there. It's, the other one is probably sturdy, but it's time to go.
Right.
What we did on this one too, Cindy, was the frame underneath. We got galvanized as opposed to just regular steel to try to get rid of corrosion problems with the salt. So last length of time it lasts, things like that we did to try to cut back.
One quick comment before I ask this gentleman's question. Well, we were doing a meeting, one of the last two meetings I had, I said to Ronnie and I said to the other younger officers, I said, gentlemen, this truck isn't for Ronnie and me. This truck is for you younger firefighters. It's going to last your longevity working for the town of Conway. Ron and I got 3 or 4 years, 2 or 3 years, before we retire. You know, we would, if we knew that we were going to build a truck for us, we wouldn't stand up here today. But we know that this truck is going to survive all these young firefighters, men and women, because we've got a few women on the board, and they're great, and possibly even some of their children. It's going to survive them.
Bob, what would it cost if you had the entry-exit point of the garage going in the other direction instead of out towards the street?
Well,
go
right
back and get the same, I mean, the vehicle that you're spending money on to tear down, could you take that money and get the standard vehicle that's already available and exit or entry the garage in a different direction?
Okay, we thought of that, but at the present time of the space that's in the garage, almost two-thirds of it's used up by the fire department and the ambulance. The other third has been cut down to highway use. Wow. And they've got barely any working bays.
What I'm saying is if you put an extension to the gravel storage side of the garage,
uh-huh,
instead of trying to go out towards the street, would that be a possibility?
I don't think you could get a permit to build there because we're so close to the river.
And how much would it cost?
And how much would it cost?
It would
cost a lot, hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Right. Lois, do you still have a question?
Yes, Lois, right.
Yeah, I want to know how computerized this is going to be.
It's not.
Is that Lois? How computerized is this going to be?
This truck, believe it or not, we've tried to keep away from as much computerization as possible. I mean, we went to all manual valves, and we could have gone to an all computerized system where you just hit a switch or hit a dial, nothing like if it works, and it would have added thousands of dollars of more money to it. Because they tried, these companies tried to sell you the biggest and the best of everything. And it's we all said that, you know. What do we do? We're going to try to keep away from as much computerization as we can because we know that, you all know when you go to computers at home, every once in a while they like to fail.
Every once in a while?
Bobby, I got one comment. Okay. Too bad the people in this room didn't go to the supper the other night at the firehouse and enjoy a hell of a meal and watch these young firemen. Watch these young firemen perform.
Mm-hmm.
And it really does an old guy's heart well to know that we're well protected with the group that's coming along.
Robin talked about the young people in the fire force, what he was talking about. I just want to let you know that 60 or 65% of the firefighters we have on our force today all were juniors at one time. They came up through the ranks from 14 years old and we trained until they're 18. They became firefighters and now they're great firefighters. As far as I'm concerned, we have four or five.
No, we're going to have six
new juniors on board right now. So the cycle is still working in Conway, and I think it's a great thing because they get the hands-on training from the older gentlemen, all the firefighters, and if any of you have any children or know of any grandchildren that live in Conway, you'd like to be members, we'd love to take them in. There's still some room. So we have approximately 24 firefighters right now and six juniors.
Minimum age is
14.
Yeah, if your house catches on fire, you'll appreciate it.
Right. I was kind of hoping that Howard Boyd was here tonight, but I see Gene, but I don't see Howard.
Oh, Howard's home.
I'm here. Howard, I shouldn't speak for Howard. Howard's a great person. He's been on my force for years until he had his fire last year. And like he said to somebody in the newspaper, he said, this sugar house of ours is not supposed to be standing. When sugar houses catch fire, they burn to the ground, as a rule. So Howard was a very modest gentleman in town, doesn't like to spend a lot of money, and like most of us don't. And I think he tends to accept this truck also, as the cost of this. And I know he made a comment to me a few weeks ago, and if I can remember exactly how he said it, he looked at the town warrant, the way that we've got this put together for financing, and he said, that is a perfect way to finance the vehicle. Don't totally exhaust all your funds, because we could totally exhaust the town funds and pay for it all up front. He felt that the town did the proper thing by taking some money out of the account, but not decimating the count and financing just a small portion of it compared to the other portion you're coming up with. And he thought there was a very, very good way of presenting it to the town.
Speaking of not exhausting all the funds, one of my big concerns is long-range financial planning for the town, mm-hmm. not just the trucks and the roads,
right.
but all the town services.
Mm-hmm.
And I should say at the outset, I don't have any problem with this fire truck. So, but I see that the Capital Planning Committee has proposed some huge expenditures. The Capital Planning Committee has not submitted a report for the town report, and is I'd like to see some of the Capital Planning Committee's thinking about the next 25 years, how many other of the fire pieces of equipment are going to be uncertifiable within 25 years, not to mention the highway trucks, not to mention the school expenses, and many, many other things. So is there anyone from the Capital Planning Committee here who can give us some context for the next 10 years at least of what it looks like we're going to have to be spending and planning for? And if there isn't anyone here, I would hope that by town meeting, they might have at least a handout to show some of their thinking.
I'm the select board representative on the long range planning committee and the capital planning committee. And it's newly reformed. I think we've had two meetings. And it just isn't all worked out yet. But Dana Goodfield is the chair. Dana's not here, is he? And the committee has tried to do is get a list of things and the values we have, and try to set up a schedule for what we think we're going to need in the future, and start putting money into a fund for that, stabilization fund, for it, so we'll be prepared. But to give you an exact list right now, I don't think we have one.
Could we sometime in the near future see this written down?
Dana has some notes on it. I will talk to Dana and other members of the committee and see what can be done soon.
Thank you.
All right.
Okay. Do we have any other questions pertaining to fire truck first?
I got one last comment.
Go ahead.
You'll hear this next week on town meeting floor. But I don't know whether it will be myself or possibly Dana Goodfield from the Capital Planning Committee setting this up. But we're going to recommend to you people that the town of Conway pay for the chassis, cab and chassis, after it's built and delivered to the body company. If we pay for that cab and chassis at that point, they're going to knock $8,339 off the cost of the vehicle. And to me, that's a fair amount of savings. We're going to pay for the fire truck anyway. The money's sitting in our account. If we come up with the $200,987 at the point that the chassis is built, they'll drop the total cost by $8,039. And I think that's a good way to go.
When is that going to be? When is that going to be?
When the chassis will be built?
Yeah, when will that?
I can't give you a date because it all depends on if the town votes it and we pass it next Thursday at the ballot question, if that's the way that they vote next week. And it's about 10 months to build a fire truck from the time you sign the order until the time the truck is delivered, 10 to 11 months. And in that 10 to 11 months, the first thing that takes place is the chassis gets built and delivered to the body company, which is all part of the same fire truck. So I'm only guessing, it would probably be 3 to 4 months before when you have to make your first payment.
Where's the company located?
What's that?
Where is the company located?
The New England Division is located in Brunswick, Maine. The Rosenbauer is made in right there, Chris.
Don't matter.
They have two factories in here. One's in North Dakota, and one is in
Nebraska,
I think. And also in our savings, and I'll be done in just a second. Also in our savings is most fire departments have a group of three firefighters that go and visit the factory. You go and visit the factory when you plan or lay out how you want your truck, and then you go and visit it when it's finished to make sure it's built the way you want it to be built. We cut down because of cost. This is all adds up into the cost of your vehicle. We made an agreement with the builder, this Rosenbauer America, that they will come to Conway at the very beginning, and we will have I'm not going to call it right, because I'm not a computer guru. They will sit down with us, have their computers out, and we will be in connection with the engineers at the factory, and the design and the layout of the truck before it starts being built is going to be done in by the headquarters here in Conway via internet access. And then the only trip that will be taken, because we're trying to save money, is at the end to make sure everything's built the way it is before it doesn't come.
And that time drive it in?
No, they drive it.
Oh.
They deliver it to you.
Oh.
They deliver it, they send up an engineer with it, and that engineer stays in Conway as long as you want them to be in town so that they can show you and operate the vehicle with every firefighter. Every firefighter gets comfortable running it. And that's staying in all their contracts.
Whose house is he staying at?
Yours. They put him up in a motel. So, to finish Jim up, or Jim, you get out of this meeting. Thank you very much. I appreciate all your concerns. We had many ourselves, and we look forward to your vote next week. And if that passes, we hope you all get out and pass the final 151,000 at the ballot box if that's how it's so voted next week. Thank you.
You hold a great diagram, Chris.
Jimmy?
One thing.
Yes, sir. Malcolm Kors.
And what Chris did last year with the ambulance.
Could you speak up, Malcolm, please?
What Chris Herman did last year in regards to the ambulance, it saved us a bunch of money. I've got all the faith in the world that he's done the same thing with the fire truck.
Right.
And he says a bunch of money with the ambulance.
All right. No pressure.
No pressure, Chris.
Thank you. Hell of a guy.
Chris?
Thanks, Chris.
He is. Okay, the next article that that had the most number of check marks was Article 21, by the way, which is about giving a $5,000 grant to the town of Montague to deal with legal services and consulting services with the pipeline thing. Now, I'm just saying that so you know what the next article is, but Mary has impressed upon me to take a 2-minute break so people can eat more desserts. And I'm kind of for that. If you want to get a dessert, get a dessert, because that was a long conference. That was at like 2 articles. So I let it go as long as 2 articles normally would. And just get some desserts, because I don't want Mary to tell me I have to take them home.
Right. Want to grow some real like this?
And that's why this meeting's better than town meeting. We're not spending money, and there's good food. All right, Article 21 is the next most checked item. And Article 21 reads as follows. To see if the town will raise and appropriate, transfer from available funds, or otherwise provide $5,000 to grant the town of Montague to provide legal and consulting services for joint cooperation with the town of Montague lead community and or its attorneys regarding Montague's intervention in Massachusetts Department of Public Utilities docket 15-178 or any subsequent assigned number, the DPU's review of a proposed contract by Berkshire Gas to purchase gas transportation on the supply path of the proposed Northeast Energy Direct Pipeline, including any regulatory or court appeals, or take any action relative thereto. By the way, this was submitted by the Pipeline Task Force, and the Board of Selectmen recommended it 3-0, and the Finance Committee recommended it 5-0. Anybody want to speak? Either side?
Why?
That's a, I guess that's a question. Does anybody want to answer the question why?
Yes.
Jim?
Joe?
Who? You. Whoever wants to start.
Go, Meg, go.
You can join us. This is the when the natural gas pipeline proposal, they have to have contracts for gas for the pipeline. Those contracts have to be approved by the Department of Public Utilities.
I understand.
Okay.
Very well.
So, Town of Montague is an intervener in that process. The only town in Franklin County that was granted that status, and so they are asking for other towns that feel it is in their interest in the to contribute to that legal.
You realize we don't have any surplus, and all these expenditures, the tax rate's going to go up. So think about that before we start peeing money away for something that's not needed. And I don't feel this is needed or the other article. Pipeline's gone for now.
Pipeline's suspended.
And all you people got broken arms and patting yourself on the back.
No, nobody's patting themselves on the back yet.
Oh, I think about it.
That's mean.
When you see signs in the main street that say, we stopped the pipeline. We didn't stop nothing. The Federal Regulatory Commission stopped it. As well.
No, FERC did not. FERC did not stop it.
Still active.
FERC did not. The application is still active with FERC. It hasn't
been. Read it the way you want to read it. I'm going home.
Okay.
Thank you for your comment.
Well, I'd like to make one comment, I guess, is that part of what this is just Berkshire Gas. Tom Pleasant's not here. Maybe he could address Berkshire Gas. But they're saying this is the only solution to the moratorium. And it appears that part of what this will do is look at the alternatives. Having Montague as an intervener and their lawyer and their expert testimony to make sure that Berkshire Gas looks at all the other alternatives, whether this is on the table or not, and it's not clear to me whether it's on or off, because there's some concern about the supply path versus the market path. But in either case, until Berkshire Gas suspends their application, they're looking to sign a contract to use the pipeline. And they haven't, as far as I know, they haven't announced that they're discontinuing the year.
Doesn't Berkshire Gas have a moratorium?
Yeah. They do.
They do, and they're saying this pipeline is the only solution.
Right.
So there's no gas for the next 20 years until the pipeline gets built.
And Montague cannot have new industry in there because there's no gas for it.
I work at Hardings, and I suspect in South Africa they can't expand either.
So why didn't we let it go through?
Make sure.
Bye, Malcolm.
That Berkshire Gas looks at the alternative, which is, you know, the building the extra tanks down in Waitley, or maybe a cross connection from some other pipeline. I've heard comments.
Discussion of repairing existing
pipelines. Repairing existing pipelines to increase their gas capacity. Do you have questions?
So, Joe and Meg, did anybody have a chance to read? It might be online already, but Kulik and Rosenberg were going to meet with them today. What was the outcome, number one, and number two, his personal opinion, having read what the Kinder Morgan CEO said to their shareholders, as reported in the reporter, they've abandoned this.
They what?
They've abandoned this project.
I've never read that anywhere.
No, but that's the surmise from there. From that guy.
Their final decision is due May 26th.
Well, they have
what they told. No,
yeah.
Yeah.
Have other towns contributed money?
Yes.
Yeah. Deerfield and the town of Leverett have both.
And there were two before.
And Gill, I think, and
Irving.
And Wendell.
Yeah, I think Northfield.
And Northfield.
And it's all been the same amount.
It's all the towns have done that. Bob, you had your...
So this was passed, though, at a time the pipeline hadn't been suspended. So there is a difference. I mean, you know, something has changed. And do you have an estimate of what it was going to cost Montague? I mean, my understanding was Montague was looking at huge legal bills that they were willing to take on, but looking for help. And whether those legal bills have changed?
They have incurred some legal costs. The expert testimony is not being paid for by Montague. My understanding is the Attorney General is paying for that.
They're estimating about $150,000 for their legal fees.
For their legal fees for this?
And that's been steady throughout.
And they vote on the 7th.
But this is specific towards examining what the basis for Berkshire Gas's
moratorium
is. So it's like a discovery and an exploration of what's behind Berkshire Gas's.
And Montague's the only town that qualifies because they're a customer. Mm-hmm. The rest of us,
right,
are not customers.
We would not have been able.
Yeah. Right. But the thing that bothers me is that Kim Morgan nor Berkshire so far has been very transparent about all of this. And the point is, if they can have this intervener status, then at least they can't hide stuff anymore and everyone can know where we stand.
So this is in support of that intervener status?
Yes, in support of the intervener status. Yes.
And my other, just to follow up on what Roy was saying, so the money, the defense fund is going to be used in a legal proceedings.
A DPU intervention.
The DPU to make sure that the moratorium they self-imposed is legitimate, that there's a legitimate reason why they are declared the moratorium, that there isn't some other way for them to access gas they can use to supply to new customers. Is that fair to say?
We were told to use words like validate. Yeah. And we're not supposed to use the word stop. This is not about stopping the pipeline.
Right.
It's about validating Berkshire Gas's need for the moratorium and why there aren't alternatives working.
To look for alternatives that they might have put on the road.
I think we'll force them to take a
specific agenda.
To take a look at the alternatives.
Yeah.
Sorry, Jim Bosman, Finance Committee. I heard this article presented, I don't know, 6 weeks ago or something when you came to the select board. And at the time, I understood that I don't remember hearing this business about understanding about this, the being able to shed light on the moratorium. My understanding was that it was to determine whether there was enough people who were willing to buy gas to show that Kinder Morgan had the local demand to justify the gas coming, right?
That's another facet to it?
The precedent agreement, I think it's called.
It all ties together because it has to do with is there subscribed capacity on the pipeline? Part of the rationale for that subscribed capacity is what Berkshire Gas has put forth as part of the need. That's why they're saying there's a moratorium, because we need this gas. So
they need the precedence agreement with Kinder Morgan to lift the moratorium. They need
that's what they're saying.
Capacity on the pipeline. That's their claim. So the moratorium and the precedence agreement are married together.
Ronnie, do you still have a question?
Yeah. I guess my question on this is why are we going to spend $5,000 because Berkshire Gas has no facilities in the town of Conway, and their moratorium has nothing to do with the town of Conway. So why are we worried about their moratorium?
I guess my short answer would be that it all ties into the need for the pipeline, and I understand that Kinder Morgan has suspended that. They have not withdrawn their application with FERC as of this time. know, and honestly, there are people in this community that, you know, work outside of this community and are impacted by whether there are, you know, whether it's new constructions, new projects outside of this community. So I think that while it may not have a direct impact on us, I think it does.
The big picture.
That's my opinion.
A bigger part of the picture is, if I may say this, Spectra pipeline is a 42-inch pipeline that's also coming through Massachusetts. When Spectra started putting theirs in, they somehow negotiated a deal that they could put a tariff on the pipeline so they wouldn't have to pay for the pipeline. They'll only be able to take the profits, and the people will have to pay them for the pipeline, plus whoever gets the gas, which is primarily going to be Europe, will pay them all that money they're going to get, and we would be left with the bill for the cost of the pipeline. Piggybacking on that, from what I just recently understand, is that Kinder Morgan said, oh, that's a great idea, so why don't we have the people pay us $5-6 billion in a tariff and a user fee for this pipeline? And if you just think about it, it's like buying a pumper truck. It's going to last, hopefully, 25 years. But we will be taxed or tariffed for 20 years to pay them $5-6 billion for something we're not going to get. It's not going to serve Conway or these other towns along the pipeline. Primarily, this is to ship it to the European market where they can get 3 or 4 times as much money for it. And there is something in our Constitution, and I think about it in this way. Money drives everything, it seems. In my opinion, this is about greed. Kinder Morgan, sitting down there in Texas, wants to put through a pipeline that we have to pay for, and we're not going to get the benefit, but they're going to make a lot of money off a limited resource and squeeze every dollar out of everybody they can in the process. And one of their vice presidents, Mr. Ford, last year at a meeting at GCC said, well, we have to respond to the market. Now, the market is Europe. So they want to come through here, along with Spectra and another pipeline and some other changes they're making, so they can make the hugest profits they can at our expense. And there's one thing in the Constitution says that you cannot take something from the people without some kind of just compensation. They're not going to compensate us for anything. And I, yes.
I just want to add one thing to clarify that I think you left out, that they're going to bill us for the gas pipeline through our electric bill. Right.
Yes.
Not the gas bill.
So right, it's an electric bill.
The tariff is on the electric. No. Proposed
yeah.
tariff.
Yeah. Yeah. Whether you get the gas or not, you're going to have to pay for it through your electric bill. It's, to me, that's not right. And I also, if we just read, what is it? The 1st, the 4th, the 5th, and the 15th Amendments. May not be the first one. But if you just read those in the Bill of Rights, the on Article 14, Section A, we're being bullied by a large, large international corporation for them to get their way, because Berkshire Gas is owned by a Spanish firm that's a big international corporation. And, you know, I feel for Tom, and I've talked to him about this. He's caught in the middle in all of this. Berkshire Gas is going to have to go along with what somebody in Spain says, and that's a moratorium. They don't have to lift a moratorium.
Who's Tom?
Tom Pleasant, that was mentioned earlier. He works for Berkshire Gas.
Lives in Conway. So, yeah. We're talking $5,000 to show support when Kinder Morgan sees stuff like that. It's just reinforcing what they've seen already,
right,
that they are not wanted here. And I don't know anything about the Spectra pipeline. I hope that we're not paying a tariff on that thing.
Well, I don't think we are, but somebody.
Okay, so this money would, in other words, some of the assumptions, Berkshire Gas may be saying, well, Heartache is going to double their gas usage in the next 5 years. We don't know if that, where are they getting that number from? So that's what some of this, these legal discovery fees will
go
for.
The intervention is to get, is to get at the heart of the truth.
Yes.
Bob Baker?
I brought up this up to Meg a couple weeks ago at our selectmen's meeting. And if for some reason next week the townspeople decide that they want to spend this $5,000, I felt it would be behooving of your committee to recommend that $5,000 come out of the $20,000 figure that we appropriated last year, that we still have a $14,750 balance in it, instead of hitting the taxpayers again for another $5,000 who were sitting on that money.
Well, if the people want to change that article, then that could be done. But the people have to vote to change the article. It's already been voted.
We're saying that we got all this money sitting in the bank and we're not using it.
Andy?
Well, now I've been distracted, Joe. I'm going to ask you a question.
Just to respond to Bob, I think Bob, certainly a week ago, we thought we might need that money. I'm not sure that we don't still need it at some point. We actually considered your comment originally. We were told by the accountant and some other people it was not a good idea to use that money. I'm not saying we can't vote to transfer it, but
why
we
are you
thought
you need the money if it's been suspended.
Well, it's been suspended. It's not abandoned, I guess is the word you use. We don't know that it's dead yet. It's not going to die, I think, until the 26th of May, or we don't know what their next step will be.
Jack?
Yeah, we could do that, but then we might have to come back in an emergency condition if they decide to start up again.
Hold on, please.
Wait.
Can you wait a second? Jack?
I just wanted to address the discovery issue, the fact that there's a lot that we don't know. How many people here know that the Spectre line blew up last Friday in a town similar to Conway? Very dramatic footage. It is not appearing on the press anywhere. You have to Google it to find out. But the pictures are incredible. Houses in
Pennsylvania.
And they don't know why. It was just underground and it just blew up. They have no idea why.
It passed its last inspection.
Yeah. Sue?
Specifically to Ron, my friend, to me the 5,000, there has been so much evasiveness and so much disinformation and so forth and so on in this, that frankly, just finding out what the heck was going on and whether they really did need what they said they needed, I mean, it's all secret, it's all a black box, and as others have said, we're supposed to pay for it. To me, for informed citizens like we have here in this room and generally in the town of Conway, to be told you've got to make decisions blind, it's just so insulting. It's so insulting. And I think the $5,000 is worth it because these things are going to come up again. The fact that the Kinder Morgan's ownership are graduates of Enron means something. I mean, they know what they're doing, but we don't know. It's just that the bill comes to us. So I want to know. I will vote for this just because of the informational thing. I think these things are going to come up, and we need to know: are they being honest and straight with us, or not?
Andy Jaffe, last word on this.
Okay, so we have to remember in all of this. I'm going to correct my good friend Malcolm in absentia here. He said that FERC stopped this. Yeah. FERC didn't do anything. No. Neither did the Mass DPU. Roy's right that the only factor that matters here is economics, and Sue's right that Kinder Morgan knows better than anybody what their capacity is, how many contracts they really have, and all that kind of thing. We don't know. And I think it would be a big mistake at this time to let them up off the mat when, in fact, I'm pretty sure they're not going to go ahead with this right now. That's my feeling about that. That's from what I've read. But
there's no government agency that's really protected us in all of this. It's a free market economy. The only thing that spoke finally was that our political pressure translated itself into economic pressure. They saw the handwriting on the wall and didn't want to spend years and millions and maybe more trying to fight this all the way to the Supreme Court. So, you know, I think we should keep the pressure on. That's my thing.
Can we amend this article? I think the motion is actually going to be contingent on their pursuing the lawsuit as well. Tom?
Tom, the motion's contingent.
Isn't the motion different than the article?
We're going to double-check the language.
It's contingent, right?
We're going to double-check the language.
We did. The motion will be, this article will be contingent on Berkshire Gas continuing with their precedent agreement hearings. If they cancel the hearing, then we don't spend the money.
There you go.
What's the lawsuit you're referencing?
It's Berkshire Gas precedent agreement, with which they filed with the DPU, is tied to the moratorium. They're saying they need Kinder Morgan's pipeline to lift the moratorium.
Does any of this relate to the recently, there was a Massachusetts pipeline, or no, yeah, Massachusetts pipeline that they wanted to extend it into Connecticut and go through Oda State Forest? Anybody know about that?
They still want to do that.
That's separate.
And Tennessee Gas Pipeline is suing the state suing Berkshire County so they can go through there. Right through protected land.
So there's a lawsuit.
That's
a lawsuit.
That's in the courts.
That's in the courts.
It's in the courts.
But that's also a storage tank. That is not a delivery tank.
Just
to paraphrase an old saying, if you believe a single word that Kinder Morgan says to you, I have a bridge for sale.
Well, if I may, an awful lot of folks are into Googling and doing computer stuff, and I'm one of those ignorant people in terms of computers, but I would suggest, take a look, Tennessee gas pipeline accidents. Just Google it and see what comes up.
Thank you.
Well, one more article had a few check marks on it, and before we go to this, I'm going to say one thing. I know Malcolm can be like 60 grit sandpaper, but he has a right to speak, just as any of us do, and I would defend any of you along with Malcolm. And he is my friend, as Andy said, my friend. He's my friend, too, even though there's a vast difference in our opinions most of the time. I just want to reassure you, I don't think he was really so mad because he stopped for one more dessert. So I think he's going to be all right. But I wish he was...
We agreed with Malcolm on everything he said up to that point.
Well, yeah.
Right?
Yeah. And the next article, I wish Malcolm was here for it, because the article that was checked was Article 9. To see if the town will raise an appropriate transfer from available funds or otherwise provide $30,000 for the 250th anniversary committee or take any other action relative thereto. And there were, three or four checks, which was that more number than any other article left. Does anybody want to speak? To that, Helen Baker?
Yeah, I'm on the 250th committee, and the reason we asked for $30,000 is because the town in the last 2 years or 3 years has appropriated $10,000 each year towards the celebration. But because of the way the calendar year goes, July to July, we had to ask for this much money now, because if we only got $10,000 this year, we'd have to have a special town meeting next year to ask for the money. Right now, at this present time, we have, between the fundraisers we've had, the money that you've been generous and appropriated so far, we have like $42,000 set aside for the celebration. But to have the whole celebration go off June 16th, 17th, and 18th, our projection, and we've put everything, we haven't got everything together yet, but we're trying to be as
years we can be, I guess, or however you want to say it, was like we're looking at $77,000 to put this weekend event on. And a lot of it is, and the reason we're asking for the $30,000 now is June of this year, we have to do all the contracts with whatever we're going to have for the parade or whatever, and none of us are going to put the money out of our own pocket. And we have to put money down, and we have to have everyone, you know, that we want come now. And a lot of it is transportation, as you know. If we have, like, just the high school bands come that we've asked, all the local towns, you're looking anywhere from $200 to $800 transportation. And they have to come. Somebody said to us, well, why can't all the parents just bring them in cars? No. Liability is the big factor. And like we are right now, on Friday night, if it all goes well, of June 16th, we're kicking it off with fireworks. We have two groups that have already donated $5,000 for fireworks, which that is the least cost because of liability, insurance, and you gotta hire a company that has all that. So that's why we're asking for $30,000 to cover all the costs, and if there's any left, or if we raise more money, because we're also putting a whole thing together where we are going to banks, like I have already gone to one bank and asked and stuff. If we don't need that much, the town will get it back.
I just want to thank the committee for all the hard work you've done so far. I really appreciate you. You've been working really hard at this.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay. Is there anything else bothering anybody they'd like to talk about? Oh, Mary, you're going to talk.
It's not bothering me, but often what happens is that we all like get up from our chairs and then we go, oh, I'll just leave my cookies here, or I'll leave my whatever here. So, and then a few of us at the end trying to clean up going,
we fight over who has to take them home.
So, please take bowls and plates and collect things to take home to kids or to take for lunch tomorrow or whatever, and take your own food home so that Jimmy doesn't have to take it all home.
Look, thank you all for
thank you, Jimmy.
Thank you.
Now, if anybody understood what was going on
with
the Festival of the Hills this year, there's been a few questions. The article is to basically separate from the process of the committee with the town. We're going to become our own 501(c). The festival is not going to stop. It's going to keep going every year, and it is for the scholarships. We're just basically not going to be under the umbrella of the town.
Sheila, thank you. Sheila just made me think of something when she said that. As most of you know, I coach girls track at Frontier Regional School. Year 17, by the way. And I heard the nicest conversation last week amongst a bunch of girls on the team. They were all saying, it was girls from other towns saying, why are there so many damn scholarships for kids from Conway? And they were having this discussion, and I thought, what a great thing to hear about Conway. Bob Baker, last word.
Last word. I got a good indication today by email. Everybody's seen the article about the Festival of Hills in Conway and all the fairs in Greenfield and the small community fairs here and there around where the fire marshals, the new FPA laws, stopped French fried brews and fried dough brews. Well, guess what?
What?
The state fire marshal's office, we got them involved, and they detuned it all, and we have a few requirements that we got to do, but they're very, very minimal, and we will have French fries.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.